ancient Sicily, Greek and local communities, so I limit that a little bit because of the time constraints and because of the evidence that we have. And maybe just before I start, in the Institute for Mediterranean Studies, we are interested in the exchange of civilizations. As an archaeologist, I would say most of the time that's about cultures, actually. Cultures are maybe a little bit below a civilization. And then there may be three main questions. So what was the way of encounter? What happened between culture A and culture B? What was the outcome if both somehow coexisted or communicated? And the third one is, what was maybe the reason when one of the culture adopted quite a lot from the other one and became kind of the other one? And in this talk, I will going to talk about number one and number three. When I say ancient Sicily, I mean basically the time between 800 BC and 500 BC. And this time is quite interesting from the viewpoint of Mediterranean studies because this is the time of the so-called Greek colonization and the Phoenician colonization. It is pretty much the first time that the entire Mediterranean was included in a communication network completely, and the agents, the carriers of these networks, were the Phoenicians and the Greeks. If I say colonization, of course, I don't mean something like what we heard from Professor Noor, right, in the New World, this exploitation of people and taking the resources from there. Maybe we can find similar elements also here, but it was not on such a large scale, and it was also not in a very steep hierarchy between the people who arrived in Sicily and the people who lived there already. So when we look at Sicily around 550 BC, then we could have a map like this. This is a simplified map, and we have in the western part the Phoenicians, we have in the eastern part Greek communities, and we have also native people. So the island was not empty when the Greek and Phoenicians arrived there. Other people would live there. From the historical sources, we know that they were called the Elymians, the Sicani, and the Sicels. The question is only if these people would address themselves in this way. Probably not. We don't have any archaeological proof that these people were organized in bigger groups. They were probably organized in smaller communities. And the same is also true, even though we speak about the Phoenicians, we talk about the Greeks, but in reality, all of these were single communities. We have Greek city-states, we have Phoenician city-states, and they would compete with each other. They would also sometimes, of course, build alliances with each other, but we are dealing here with a kind of complex situation. So usually we talk about like the lower layer here, ethnic groups and tribes, but in reality we need to look at all these single communities because they would have different ways of interaction with each other. So if you would like to find a way to describe the situation, to understand the encounters and what are possible things we have to look at, then we can, of course, use different kind of frameworks. I found this one from Social Psychology, published already in 1982, so a little bit older research, but I think it's still valuable and can be used. So these are major dimensions of cross-cultural contact. And we can see to describe that, actually, main variables are, for example, where does the meeting take place, when, so the time span of the contact, the purpose, type of involvement, frequency of contact, and so on. Just to let you know, of course, these kind of variables were derived from more modern examples, so it would be possible to interview people, to make surveys, to observe them. This is, of course, something we cannot do for ancient people anymore, but I think it is at least possible to look at some of these variables and make some informed guess, or even sometimes we also have evidence for that. And interesting are also the potential outcomes of cultural contact, and because very often in Mediterranean studies we stress this convergence of cultures and civilizations and so on, and I think sometimes maybe we forget that of course there's also a lot of violence going on, and there are armed conflict, And so two outcomes are actually genocide. If two different groups are meeting each other, then we have something like assimilation, segregation, and integration. We could potentially observe violence, yeah? Genocides, for example, if one city is destroyed by another one, we cannot really figure out assimilation. And integration is also possible to observe in the archaeological record. So we have information about the Greek settlements in Sicily. We know when they were founded. We have actually two waves. The first Greek settlement that was founded in Sicily that we know of is Naxos in 734 BC, and then the end of the first wave of foundation is Gela with 688 BC. As you can see, we have some information, archaeological and historical, about the interaction of the native people with the Greeks. And we see that actually both happened. We have violent encounters, and we also have peaceful. And sometimes it's even mixed, like in the case of Leontini, where first of all, the natives would live together with the Greeks, according to the historical sources, but then the Greek people would very soon kick out the natives from the city. We don't know why, actually, but we see that the situation is actually quite difficult. It's complex. It's complicated. This is actually what I wanted to say. It's a complicated situation. So we can look at this and can try to understand it a little bit. The point is, this is the initial phase. This is just the beginning when the cities were founded, but of course they would exist there and the other people were also there, and it doesn't give us any information about what happened after that. And I suggest that we can define four different stages. Number one is actually the time of the first encounters before the settlements were founded, the Greek settlements in Sicily. Then we have the time of the city foundations. Then we have a normalization phase, which I cannot really pinpoint with dates. I will explain very soon why. And then we have a phase or a stage of colonial expansion and an intensified acculturation of the local people. And if I say acculturation, then I mean two-sided acculturation, so there is never a one-sided. Stage number one, first encounters. We can actually trace that back before Greek people really arrived there, that there were some contacts. We have, for instance, pottery that dates from 800 to 750 BC. You just have to believe me now when I'm telling you this. And it is distributed in Sicily, as you can see, on the eastern coastline, but also in the inland. So when the Greek people arrived there and founded their first cities, they didn't come into an area that was completely unknown to them. The second stage then of the city foundations, we also have Greek artifacts in local contexts. So again, you have to believe me that these maybe not so appealing pots are from the Greeks and that they were used by the locals. Maybe just to let you know, if you see this specific map here, this just shows Sicily, but if you would look at the entire Mediterranean, then we would see this is a development of a kind of globalized taste in the Mediterranean world. Greek pottery is distributed in the eastern part of the Mediterranean quite a lot, also in the central part, and with ongoing time also increasingly in the western part. And here we see a map, which is, by the way, not for me, unfortunately. I wish I could have done that, where we can see the amount of imports from the Aegean area and from the Levant. And it is not so much about where things are coming from, just where they are distributed, and you can see they're distributed along the shoreline, the place where the Greek cities were founded. So the normalization stage is something that is difficult to give precise dates, because I would argue it is different for each region. So when Naxos was founded 734, then the normalization stage with the locals there is different compared to 688 in Gela. And the reason is, I think it is all related to the collective identity and to the collective memory. The collective memory can be actually divided, according to Jan Assmann, quite famous cultural scientist, in different memories. And the two most important are the communicative memory and the cultural memory. And the arrival of the Greek people is in all likelihood part of the communicative memory. And this is something that exists actually just for 80 to 100 years, so 3 to 4 generations, and then it is forgotten. So we can argue that after 4 generations, latest, the Greek people who lived in Sicily were kind of considered to be locals. The fourth stage is then expansion and this intensified acculturation. Expansion you can see on the left side. This is from Syracuse, a very important city in Sicily, and it expanded its sphere of power, or its sphere of interest, from 500 to 600 and also included native sites. And if you see on look on the right side, then you see a very famous site in Sicily, in central Sicily. It is the city of Morgantina, a native settlement, and it shows strong signs of urbanism, something that we couldn't see before with the local cities. We have a fortification. When we look at the imports, then we can see now the picture is completely changing, right? Because we see now that imports are also distributed in the inland, not just along the coast. And also when we look at the burial customs, for instance, here is again from Morgantina, we see that there is a mix of local burial customs with Greek burial customs. And very often, interestingly, children are buried under the Greek rituals and the adults are buried under the local rituals, which is, in my opinion, a sign that Greek people lived in these kind of native settlements. So if you would like to summarize it now, and maybe that looks a little messy, I really tried to find a good way to put this all together and, you know, according to these variables that were defined before. So I think it is possible to describe something. The problem with that is that I summarized it. I put information from different sites together, so of course everything is a little bit blurred. It would be much better to have the opportunity to make a similar table for each single site and then maybe merge them together. This is, however, at the moment not really possible because the sources are not available and so probably we have to wait a little bit longer until we can make this for several sites at once. So, but in any case, I would argue that these insights from social psychology are useful for describing the encounter in different ways and what happened. But this is, of course, not an explanation how things happened. And this would be then my next step, because if you look here at the pottery, for example, from a local site, Monte Policello, it's in central Sicily, and we see here some shapes that are kind of local interpretation of Greek pottery. So it is not exactly an imitation of Greek pottery, it's a kind of reinterpretation, yeah, some inspiration taken and then some additions here and there. And this lower one is maybe interestingly this dish, because this is an imitation of a Phoenician shape. Yeah. So it's not only that the Greek shapes were somehow favored, also the Phoenicians had some influence, even though we cannot observe that very well so far in the archaeological record. Maybe a little bit more impressive is this map here, because it shows the distribution of vessels with the graffito in Sicily. So these are these kind of inscriptions. They are using the Greek script, very often kind of scratched on pottery shards, but also on other objects. And if we look here, so around, roughly, 590 up to 450 or something like this, how it is distributed, then we see also not only in the locations of the colonies, but also in the inland sites, people apparently used the Greek script. And I could show you now a lot of these slides and could show you that there is something that is called a Hellenization process, yeah? The adoption of Greek elements. And in the end, it looks like as if the local population became something like Greeks themselves. So how did it happen? At the contact period, the first stage and the second stage that I showed you, so the before the foundation of the cities and during the foundation of the cities, we see that foreign goods, foreign objects actually go into Sicily to the local populations. And if we imagine what happened actually, we have strangers approaching the settlement. And who is communicating with these strangers? Of course, not just some random person. We can actually assume that this is the upper layer of the society. They are dealing with them because these people coming to the settlements, they might be merchants. They might be kind of delegations from cities. Exchange of goods, of gifts, actually, is part of the communication at this time. And so the local elite group, they would get now some foreign goods. And foreign goods are actually something special, and we can see that until today when we, I don't know, we travel somewhere, then we buy a souvenir, or we make a picture, and to, somehow to prove that we were there, and we have some lead maybe towards other people in this regard. Yeah, we went there, and it makes us special in some way. And elite distinction is something, it's a kind of, it's almost like a mechanism that we can really observe in many parts of the world at different times. So the elite would use these foreign goods for the purpose of distinction, to be different from the other people in the society. What usually happens then is that the other people in society also want to have these goods, and then a process sets in that is called elite emulation. As long as the elite group can restrict the access to the goods, they can use that for the purpose of distinction. When this is not possible anymore, and we have to imagine, you know, there are these Greek merchants, and they come more frequently now, they bring in all these goods. Goods were also produced in the Greek cities. So now we have an oversupply. And we have this pottery, which is somehow the Mediterranean taste at this time, but it is not something that is very valuable. It is, in the end, something also how to use the pottery. There are some kind of customs, how to drink wine, how to prepare it, and so on. And in the next step, the elite now would actually try to get other goods. For example, stuff that is imported maybe from the Aegean or from the Levant, more valuable things. If this is also not working again, what can the elite do now to keep this kind of distinct status? And by the way, they need to distinct themselves, they need to have this for separating themselves from the, let's say, commoners, because this is a kind of, it's the base of their legitimation, right? They get the authority, they derive authority from that. So what happens is, if these goods are not good enough anymore for distinction, the local elite would now adopt customs. For example, language, dressing style, just different ways to deal with that, right? So we see that here in this case with the burial customs, adopting Greek burial customs. And I would say this is a kind of cycle that is starting now. It's introducing these foreign objects from the Greeks, and then it's just for the purpose again to be different from the others and adopting more and more, and in the end, after several generations, they are kind of like Greeks by themselves, Hellenized. And what makes this actually special, so I try to put this here in these diagrams, is that when we imagine Greek merchants are coming into the local settlements or the local communities, then they would communicate with the elite, and they actually build up the connection into the Mediterranean network. We already have a Mediterranean network there, built up by the Phoenicians and by the Greeks into the Eastern Mediterranean, and now the local elite in Sicily can be part of that. But since this kind of connection is a little bit unstable, in the next step, we can imagine, and this happened also in other places of the world, that these merchants get some kind of accommodation inside the local community, inside the settlements, and because this is building up now a stable connection into this global network. And from there, the Greek merchants, the people who actually spread this Greek culture or these Greek cultural elements, they would then proceed into other sites. And I'm really happy that I'm already at the conclusion now. I have even a little bit of time, but it's good. So my conclusion in this regard is that Sicily is a complex setting of communities, or there was a complex setting of communities on this island at the time between 800 and 500 BC. And what we observe is a wide range of interactions and responses. So that's why all these kind of generalizations are actually problematic. And I would also argue this is the same for later times. Yeah, when we say these people kind of went well together and so, and everything was nice, yeah, maybe, but we have to just to consider that there are different responses by different communities. And we should look at this and we should try to understand that first before making some generalizing conclusions. So the adoption of Greek culture elements started before the first city foundation. So Sicily was a known area for the Greeks. And we see an increased acculturation process, but it's not the same for all regions of Sicily. I would argue that the adoption of Greek customs was a kind of voluntary association. So we have a circle of elite distinction and emulation that led to the increased adoption of Greek elements by the locals. And now it comes. The inclusion of these Greek cultural elements is not a sign of cultural backwardness by these locals, because that was very often assumed by earlier generations of scholars. They would say the Greek people were so superior in their culture, so it's completely clear that the locals, which are kind of backward and inferior, would just adopt that. It is not like that. It is actually the connection to a global Mediterranean network. This is the global Mediterranean taste. Yeah, and it shows just that these communities become kind of integrated in this network. They are, if you want, mundane in some way, right? They are travelers, or even if they didn't travel, they implicate that they know the world outside and that they are connected with that. And with this being said, I'm at the end of my presentation. Thanks a lot for your attention.